Hello, and thank you for tuning in to the Final Draft Write On podcast. I'm your host, Pete D'Alessandro, and the product manager here at Final Draft. This is the screenwriting podcast where we talk about all things filmmaking. Today, we have Mimi Leader on to discuss On the Basis of Sex, that is, the story of Ruth Bader Ginsburg. Mimi Leader was the first female graduate of the AFI Conservatory. She has directed stuff from L.A. Law, Deep Impact, The Leftovers, and you may know that she won 2 Emmys for directing ER. Mimi Leader, welcome to Write On.
Thank you. It's good to be on Write On.
So I want to just jump right into the script and to the story. So what attracted you to this script, and where did you find it? What was the beginning of this for you?
Well, Robert Court, our incredible producer, and Jonathan King, our other incredible producer and president of Participant Media, sent me the script, and I immediately read it, and I knew I had to make this movie. Once I read it, I felt an instant connection to RBG, and I hadn't always known about her. I always knew about Justice Ginsburg and who she was and her role on the Supreme Court, but I never knew about her in a personal way, how she was depicted in the script. And so I felt that I was the one that had to do this film. I felt like I was uniquely qualified because I felt that I had a lot of commonalities with her. I grew up in the late 60s and was a feminist and anti-war protester and women's rights, and fighter for equality. But I also, as a woman who has lived quite a bit of a time, I felt like there were a lot of commonalities. We were both Jewish, both mothers, and both have had longstanding marriages, and both have broken the glass ceiling in our own ways and for generations to come and in different generations. And I'm not comparing my accomplishments to hers, no way, but I am saying we both did this in very different industries. And so this movie is about how change can happen. You know, what was very also very important and that I understood very personally is having been in a marriage for a long time and having an equal partnership, which immediately struck me that this was absolutely this love story was inherent to the material. It was there in the script, and it was essential to Justice Ginsburg's character and who she became as a woman and as a partner. The script and the movie shows that what love and family can bring to an individual, whether it's your own family or the family you make. We all need champions, and we all need love. And hers was one of the greatest love stories of all time, in that Marty Ginsburg was one of the most progressive men in the 50s. And to this day, you know, he was a unique man. He shared in the parenting in the 50s. He did the cooking. She did the thinking. A quote from Jane Ginsburg. She was a horrible cook. And you know, they raised their kids together, they argued law, they had a love for what they were doing. He became one of the preeminent tax attorneys in the country. He rose to the top while she kept having the door slammed in her face.
Did you relate to that part personally, that she had a lot of barricades and she watched someone else not have those same barricades right next to her?
Well, yeah, I really understand what it is like and feels like to, you know, be stopped and have doors closed in your face, and you're not good enough, you're not strong enough, you're not this, you're not that. And no matter how good you are, and I'm not just talking about myself, but I think women are constantly having to prove ourselves over and over again in this male-dominated industry.
That certainly comes across in the script. What were the first pieces of that where you realized, all right, well, this is going to be part of the movie. This is going to be something we're going to accomplish in the movie, or we want to accomplish in the movie. Where did that start germinating for you?
Say the beginning part again.
What was it that spoke to you there? Then you thought, all right, well, I have this opportunity to bring some of this stuff to light. Where do I do that in the script? And did that stuff jump out at you? Where were the ideas and the germs of that beginning for you as you read this and got involved with the project?
Well, most of the scenes were there, but there they're all laid out throughout the script in terms of, are you talking about, you know, the slights, the pats on the back, you know, the office party when she's adrift and alone, she doesn't fit in with the women, she doesn't fit in with the guys, and the boss, Marty Ginsburg's boss, is pandering, you know, is telling her, you married a star. And then you have this scene in the street, which actually we did rewrite, where she, you know, he doesn't get it. Like, you don't get it, Marty, you know, all the slights, all the pats on the back. And she had to go into teaching because she couldn't find a job as a lawyer. No one would ever hire her because she was either, you know, she was a woman and she was Jewish and, you know, her faith got in her way and her femaleness got in her way. But she was smarter than all of them. And so in the street, so she became a teacher, which I understand she loved. And, you know, her husband's saying, why isn't that good enough? You're teaching the next generation to change the next generation of lawyers to change the world. And she screams at him, that's what I wanted to do. And actually that scene was not in the script and we wrote it because that's the truth. And the truth is that then Marty had to step up to the plate and he brought her this tax case and he was always in support of her. It was, you know, this was the first case they ever tried together and the last one.
And it was really, I mean, in the script, in the movie, it really puts out that they stick their necks out for this. I mean, Marty takes some risks politically and this is a big risk. And that whole case winds up being a giant risk for everyone. I mean, just the whole country. So were you trying to mirror that? I mean, just the magnitude of that and tying that to those personal stakes, was that something that was that deliberate?
Absolutely. This film, I think I said, is about how change happened. And it's not a biopic. It's, you know, we all know she had an extraordinary life. And so this movie focuses on a specific time of her life where Marty brought her this case and they won against all odds and overturned 178 different laws that discriminated on the basis of sex. And, you know, what was there to lose? Really?
Right. One more precedent, as they say, it wouldn't matter.
Yeah, exactly.
So what was the relevance of all this today? Because this is, you know, this is 50 years ago. I mean, why now?
Well, why now? Because we've come so far and yet we have so much farther to go. We need change. Ruth is, you know, often referred to as a superhero, but she's not. She's a woman. She's a woman who, like countless generations of women before her and since, withstood subtle slights and overt discrimination of a culture around her. Women today still feel those slights. But she's a woman who used her smarts and her voice and changed that culture, you know, with her smarts, intelligence, her eloquence. And she did it with the support of, you know, Marty Ginsburg, as I've been saying, and she made the country more equal and more free for women alike. And so this is that, you know, and she made us look at discrimination on the basis of sex isn't just a woman's issue. You know, it's an injustice that affects everybody. And I think if people looked at it that way, more change would happen. But there's still a lot more to change. You know, as the culture changes, you know, we have to, and, you know, and goes against these outdated laws. The rule of law, you know, the laws have to be changed. And right now we're in such a poisonous period in American history. One of the things Ruth is so great at is she's brilliant at persuading people to listen. You know, she's brilliant at getting the other side to listen without destroying them. And I just think we all have to listen to each other more and use our voices to make this place a better place.
Well, using your voice to make this world a better place certainly seems your wheelhouse. What do you What do you do in this movie as a director? There are lots of things I think I hope I picked on a few that directors get to do that are subtle and the audience doesn't necessarily notice on a conscious level. But what were some of those things that you're putting into on the basis of sex that maybe if we watch this once we won't notice, but maybe on a few viewings we would?
Well, in the beginning of the film, I really wanted her to be in the sea of men. I wanted her to not be in like an overt color like red or yellow. Blue is RBG's favorite color, and I felt it was a really important color to use quite often on her. So EC Musendin, our brilliant costume designer, found this beautiful cornflower blue dress that swayed in the wind. And I wanted to put her in a sea of men of black, grays, and brown suits. And, just to show, how, this little dot was among all these men walking into her future. And the end of the film actually was not written this way. The end of the film was had a different ending. And one day I was standing in front of the Supreme Court steps and I was talking to my director of photography, the outstanding director of photography, Michael Grady, and we hadn't started shooting yet, and we were standing in front of the Supreme Court steps, and I had this idea. I wanted Ruth Bader Ginsburg to walk up the steps. I wanted Felicity, our Ruth Bader Ginsburg, to walk up the steps into her and ascend to her future. And then I said to him, and I want her to morph into RBG. And so I pitched it to my producers, and most of them were really keen on the idea, and some were, it was like, not sure. And what if it doesn't work? What are we going to tell her? I knew it was going to work. So I wrote her a letter and I asked her if she'd appear in the film.
Wow.
And she did, hence the end of the film. And so that was a big change because the end was quite different. And I'm glad we did break that wall. I think it was important. And I mean, I did, I mean, in terms of viewing it again, like, so blue was a theme. And as she got older, like 35, 36, I wanted her to ascend to her future in a deeper blue, to say that she was like as deep as the ocean, that what she had done, how she had changed this country. I mean, that's how I think of things. And so the color was important to me. And so EC designed the dress that Felicity Jones wore. And then we had to find a dress and a coat for Ruth Bader Ginsburg. And I asked her, we were coming to her apartment. We brought a whole rack of blue coats and dresses. And there was this one Max Mara coat that I was obsessed with that I felt, please pick it, please pick it. And, I didn't tell her anything. I just said, we have this rack of clothing. Why don't you take a look and see what you like? And she went right to it, right to the Max Mara. And so I knew it was fate.
Or
She tried
certainly that
that.
you'd understood her, that's for sure.
Yeah, it was really interesting. It made me very happy.
Oh, that's great. That is a great place to leave it. Mimi Leader, thank you so much for
Okay.
doing this. Can you tell us really quick where we can see on the basis of sex?
Yes, it opens regionally December 25th, Christmas Day, A Little Gift Under the Tree. And on January 11th, it opens wide. So please go see it and enjoy it.
Mimi, thank you so much. You guys have been great. I really appreciate you doing this.
Of course. Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
All right.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. And thank you to our audience for listening. If you enjoy our podcasts, please let us know by subscribing on iTunes and leaving us a review. You can also stay in the know by following us on Facebook or find us on Twitter as @FinalDraftInc and Instagram as @FinalDraftScreenwriting. Until then, write on.